wondered why the chairman has not turned up. So they appointed somebody else to do the job at the last minute. But these are experiences which I have narrated on in a different context. I won't go further on into that. But this particular lecture, Radhakrishnan Memorial Lecture, brings me personally great honor and pleasure. My early years were spent in the campus of Banaras Hindu University, and I recall seeing Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan from a distance on several occasions. These occasions included some of his lectures, like the Sunday Gita lecture, and also his chats and discussions with my father, who, being a well-read academic, got on well with him. I may confess to feeling overawed by his impressive personality, but even though I was at that time with a single-digit age, I could not help being impressed by his scholarly appearance. One occasion that is engraved in my memory was when Dr. Radhakrishnan visited our house for a formal dinner party, which was hosted by my father in honor of a visiting commission which was chaired by him, by Dr. Radhakrishnan. As the assembled invitees were enjoying pre-dinner chat, we had a badminton court in our campus, and it was used on such occasions for people meeting before dinner, not playing badminton. It was dark at night. So at that time, while they were chatting along, they suddenly were surprised to hear Sanskrit shlokas being sung. These were Shankaracharya's well-known Dasha Shloki, of which I will just read out the first shloka. Na bhumir na toyam na tejo na vayo na kam netriyam vana tesham samuha anaikanti katmat sushukte kasitha tadeko vashishta shiva kevaloka. This was the first stanza, and there were 10 of these. The recitation, coming from a distance on a quiet evening, sounded to many listeners like Akashwani, and like many other people present there, Dr. Radhakrishnan wondered if the shlokas that were being sung in tuneful and chaste Sanskrit came from a gramophone record. It sounded like a gramophone record. My father clarified that the recitation was done by his two sons, who had specially prepared the recital for the occasion. So on that, Dr. Radhakrishnan called us and conveyed his appreciation in his usually measured tone. But that created a great impression on me, even at that age. In later years, when I went to Cambridge, the appreciation and encouragement that I received from him went a long way towards making me aspire for greater academic achievements. I recall in particular the occasion when I applied for a Jayant endowment scholarship to study in Cambridge, and Dr. Radhakrishnan was kind enough to write to the endowment director a letter in support of my application. That may have been why it succeeded, despite being late for that year. These past links explain why I readily accepted Professor Mungekar's invitation to deliver this particular lecture. The occasion gives me an opportunity to pay my own humble tributes to a great intellectual. Indeed, it will be hard to think of anyone who did so much to simplify and amplify Indian philosophy for the Indians as well as for the foreigners. My topic today concerns the question of human existence and the perspectives offered by science on it. A lot has been written or talked on various aspects of human existence in various philosophies. However, in recent times, the rapid growth of science has made it desirable to include the perspectives from science also. This is why I wish to highlight in my talk today why science is important in considering these issues. And being a student of cosmology, I cannot help bringing the overall cosmic picture into our present discussion. So I wish to ask a question as to what, if any, cosmic connection relates the presence of man to the universe as we see it today. Of course, scholars have debated this issue as part of philosophy, as I have said, and what I have to say may appear quite shallow compared to the depths attained by previous thinkers. Indeed, on this occasion I can recall Kalidasa's words at the beginning of Raghuvansha, in which he says that he felt like a dwarf trying to pick up a fruit from its height, which is way above its reach. So he jumps and but can't get hold of the fruit. And it becomes more and more ridiculous. So I apologize in advance should my efforts today disappoint you from that point of view. So, to set up the scenario, let us start with a brief description of the universe in terms of the teachings and ideas of Aristotle, which had man as the most important part of creation, residing at the center of the cosmos. Aristotle had a whole range of ideas on nature, which influenced the intellectuals of the succeeding generations for no less than 20 centuries. And the human ego worked itself into an uncompromising frame, where only the geocentric view was accepted. That is, you had to assume that the Earth was at the center of the universe. Thus, Copernicus and Galileo had to suffer for proposing the alternative heliocentric theory, in which the central piece was the Sun rather than the Earth. The crux of the matter was, does the Sun go around the Earth, as Aristotle believed, or does the Earth go around the Sun? Of course, if the universe consisted of only the Earth and the Sun and nothing else, the above question is undecided. You can take any as going around the other. However, we have a backdrop of distant stars against which background we can pose the above question. It is interesting to know that as early as the 3rd century BC, a Greek thinker, Aristarchus of Samos, had argued that the Earth goes around the Sun in 1 year. So within 6 months, if you observe a star from today and 6 months later, its direction against the overall background will have changed. It is like myself walking across the stage and looking at the people, their relative direction would change as I walk from here to there. So, One would expect the direction of the star to change when viewed in 6 months. By what angle? Aristarchus was asked this question by observers. And here he gave an answer, but he had overestimated the effect because his estimates of stellar distances were much lower than usual, than actual. In those days, the actual distances were not really measured. The observing techniques in those times were very primitive, and so even the enhanced expectation of Aristarchus was not seen, and this led to a firmer belief in the geocentric theory. But the important thing was that Aristarchus had thought of a test for the hypothesis. Now, when Galileo was asked by the Inquisition for a proof of the heliocentric theory, he came up with the wrong answer. Quoting the analogy of water spilling out of a moving glass, if you have a glass filled with water and walk with it, the water will spill out because it's very hard to keep the water still in the glass. So Galileo felt that because there are tides in the ocean, the water is sort of going round and round, and that is because the earth is moving. And that was his explanation, which was of course not correct. The tides are caused by gravitational effects of the moon and the sun, which of course were not known in those times. But the Inquisition was not interested really in what Galileo said. They had already made up their mind as to what the final answer was. So there doesn't seem to have been much difference because of this wrong answer. So what happened was that later on people began to do the test which Aristarchus had suggested of observing the star in 6 months gap, and they finally found, and that was in 19th century as late as that they could confirm this because the measurement techniques were accurate. But the result was that the earth was shown to be moving. There is another test which was done in the 18th century, which was aberration, and that also showed that the earth is moving. So, although the initial idea that the earth is at the center of the universe was disproved in this way, the human ego held on to the fact that, okay, if the earth is not at the center, the sun is at the center, so we can say that the whole universe goes around our sun and we are ourselves going around it. That is part of the whole game. So ego is always there to keep man in a very important position. So given that the sun is at the center of the solar system, it was generally believed that the sun is also at the center of the Milky Way galaxy. By 19th century, people had a preliminary picture of the galaxy, which is a collection of stars and which we call the Milky Way. Now this collection was first put on a map in 1785 by Herschel, and that map shows the sun at the center of the galaxy. And it was believed that the sun is at the center and all other stars are going around the galaxy. So thereby the human ego was still satisfied that the earth, that they are occupying an important position. But this also was proved to be illusory, and when better telescopes came at the dawn of the 20th century, it was shown that the sun is not at the center of the galaxy, but it is 2/3 of the way out from the center, two-thirds of the way of the whole diameter of the galaxy. So you find that there has been always a tendency for putting man at the center of the argument and then argue that the universe is designed like this or that. So there was one more instance in which the majority opinion based directly or indirectly on the human ego had assumed that our galaxy was the only one of its kind in the universe. So this was the next step. If the sun is not important, well, our galaxy is the most important thing. And the argument was made that there is no other galaxy that we see through our telescope. Only our galaxy is what we see. So this was the majority opinion for a long time, right up to the first decade of the 20th century. And I want to quote the following lines from a popular book of astronomy written by Agnes Clark in 1904. She was a very good science popularizer. And she says, "The question whether nebulae are external galaxies hardly any longer needs discussion. It has been answered by the progress of research. No competent thinker with the whole of the available evidence before him can now, it is safe to say, maintain any single nebula to be a star system of the coordinate rank of with the Milky Way." There were people arguing that there are cloud-like things, fuzzy things seen at different parts of the sky. And they were, in fact, big galaxies very far away, so they are looking very small. That was the argument that the minority were making. But the majority opinion is what Agnes Clark has said. And she said that evidence points that there is none of those fuzzy things are comparable to our Milky Way. Well, having said this, within two decades of this confident assertion, it was shown to be wrong. Our universe is known to contain at least 10 billion galaxies, like our Milky Way, within the observable range of our best telescope. So here we are living on a tiny planet of a medium star, moving in a galaxy of some 100 billion stars, the galaxy being one among 10 billion others observable within that range. The entire mass made of stars and galaxies may be as high as that of 1,000 billion suns. 1 billion I am using is the American billion of 10 to the power 9, 9 zeros after 1. So aware of this enormous gap between man and the universe, how big the universe is and how tiny we humans are, the Cambridge astronomer Arthur Stanley Eddington remarked, he says that man in his search for the knowledge of the universe is like a potato bug in a potato in a sack lying in the hold of a ship trying to fathom the nature of the vast sea. So you can see how difficult the job is trying to understand our real location, real significance. Now this quote coming from one of the great astrophysicists and cosmologists of recent times may sound pessimistic. If we are like potato bug, we won't end up knowing anything. But despite daunting odds against the effort, scientists have insisted on giving it a try. Testifying to the successes achieved in this venture, Albert Einstein once remarked, "The most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible." So I will return to this statement later in this talk. The quest in this instance is aided by observations as well as theories, both combining to form a self-consistent framework. This is how the scientific process goes. However, as we saw, the paradigm carries the unstated assumption that man is somehow important to the universe. the approach is still pragmatic in the sense that if something does not fit in the paradigm, there is scope for modification. In this spirit, let us look at some examples of the so-called anthropic approaches, where the fact that man exists is considered important. My approach may sound long-winded, but it will eventually get there. So I request you to be patient as my argument proceeds. So to illustrate it, I will start with the question, what makes the sun shine? Well, there are some experts sitting in the audience, so I will be very careful. This question has been raised by some most civilizations who in the early days concluded that the sun possessed divine power in order to shine so bright. Temples devoted to the sun bear testimony to this effect. The progress of science, however, led to attempts to solve this question within the known scientific framework. Eventually, scientists like Eddington constructed solar models in which all the matter which constitute the mass of the sun estimated to be around 2 billion, billion, billion tons is held together in equilibrium between two opposing forces. One of these is the sun's own gravity, which acted so as to reduce its size. It tries to pull in all the matter inwards. While there are internal pressures due to gas and radiation which try to blow the sun outwards. So there has to be an equilibrium between the two. And perhaps you will be surprised to hear, if there were no pressures at all in the sun will shrink. And how fast will it shrink? It will take 29 minutes to shrink to a point. This is what our mathematics tells us. So it tells you how important it is to have these opposing forces in the form of pressures. So the pressures come from the central temperature, which is very high. Eddington's calculations showed that the central temperature may exceed 10 million degrees. So the question before him was, what is the kind of source of heat which the sun has at the center that gives it the high temperature? And he took cue from the statements by the French Nobel laureate Jayant and concluded that at such high temperatures, nuclear fusion acts and nuclei get fused together. So you have basically a fusion reactor. And that produces the heat. Now this was in the early 1920s, and the idea of nuclear fusion was far remote from the physics then in vogue. Still, Einstein's special theory of relativity was sufficiently well established for scientists to understand Eddington's reasoning. This was simple enough. Take four hydrogen nuclei with a positive charge each and bring them together. And when they come together, because of their fusion, there is a tendency for them to fuse together. They form a helium nucleus. And the helium nucleus has a mass slightly less than the four hydrogen nuclei which went into the reaction. So you have evidently lost some mass. And if you are an auditor of your mass and energy balances, you will find that there is something wrong in the bookkeeping. Left-hand side doesn't agree with the right-hand side. But there is a way to resolve this. You have the formula E equal to mc squared of Einstein, which tells you that whatever mass you lost will appear as energy. And that is the energy that the sun is drawing upon. This is what Eddington said. Now in those days, the nuclear physics as a subject was in the very elementary stage. And it was not known how the nuclear fusion process would operate. And one thing that you can always see from even your school physics, that if you have positive charges, they will repel each other. So if you had four positive nuclei of hydrogen, to bring them together will be very difficult because they will try to repel each other. So the nuclear physicist said that even though Eddington is talking of very high temperatures, that temperature is not high enough for these particles to be thrown so fast towards each other that they fuse into one. So they did not buy the argument which Eddington was giving. So Eddington in his textbook has come back on his critics with the following sentence. The book is called Internal Constitution of Stars, written in 1926. We do not argue with the critic who urges that stars are not hot enough for this process. We tell him to go and find a hotter place. That was Eddington's repartee. And of course in the Western culture, hell is supposed to be very hot. And so to say go to hell, this is good, he is saying in a polite language, go and find a hotter place. However, in about a decade or so, nuclear physics developed to a level where Eddington's solution could be verified and passed as correct. In 1939, nuclear physicist Hans Bethe constructed realistic solar models and showed that you can generate energy from the center of the sun by this fusion process. The longest part of the star's life is spent in this way when it is converting hydrogen to helium. I don't think there is any horizontal surface here. It underweighs. So this success of the sun's model led astrophysicists to greater challenges. I am still building up my argument, so you may be wondering whether I am lost somewhere. But no, I am coming there. And as and when the sun exhausts all its core hydrogen, what will it do? The appeal to nuclear physics suggested adding more neutrons and protons to the helium nucleus. However, there was a serious problem. Helium has atomic mass 4, and by adding proton to it, to make a new nucleus of atomic mass 5. People tried that, but such a nucleus is not stable, it breaks back. The other alternative is to take two helium nuclei and add and make a nucleus of mass 8, 4 plus 4. But that is also unstable, so it breaks back. So you can imagine yourself climbing a ladder to reach to higher and higher, bigger and bigger nuclei. But at some place, if you put your foot on the next rung of the ladder, it breaks. So you say, okay, I will go three rungs higher. That is known to be another rung there. So you put your foot there and that also breaks. So how do you climb up this ladder? That is the kind of question which was facing the scientists. And the expectation was that if you can do this, you can in fact make all the chemical elements that you see in the universe, make them inside stars. So if you take the case of the sun, a star of solar mass would continue to draw energy from its core fusion reactor for about 12 billion years. This reactor, as we just saw, fuses hydrogen to make helium. And the question comes, after this source of energy is lost, what will happen to the star? So it will start shrinking. And when it starts shrinking under gravity, the reverse effect comes, that because it gas is being compressed, it heats up. So you get a heated